Introduction. One day, around 20 years ago, I was wandering through a bookstore in Brooklyn when I noticed something weird. There were books about music, books about sports, books about art, photography, ichthyology, tantric sex, but few about video games. Had there been such a thing as texting at the time, I would have thought, WTF. I'd grown up during the so-called golden age of gaming in the late 1970s and early 80s, weaned on the Atari 2600, Merlin, Simon, Mattel Football, Defender, Galaga, and my personal favorite, Crazy Climber. By now, the mid-90s, we were deep into computer games, particularly the swelling wave of first-person shooters, most notably Doom. The first big web browser, Netscape, had just been released, and a new generation of games online seemed inevitable. Why then, I wondered, wasn't I seeing more books chronicling this world? 2 decades later, here I am, writing this new afterword to the book that resulted from that epiphany, Masters of Doom, the story of John Carmack and John Romero, co-creators of the seminal shooters Doom and Quake, and their company, id Software. First published in 2003, the book chronicles how Carmack and Romero rose from broken homes to create some of the most influential and controversial games of their generation. To me, it was a class tale of gumption and innovation, and an inspirational one at that. In the years since the book came out, I've reported many stories about gamers and game developers, several of which are included in this collection, who cite the two Johns as influences. If Carmack and Romero could do what they did, many people think, so can I. As Carmack says toward the end of the book when he tells me about their legacy, in the information age, the barriers just aren't there. The barriers are self-imposed. If you want to set off and go develop some grand new thing, you don't need millions of dollars of capitalization. You need enough pizza and Diet Coke to stick in your refrigerator, a cheap PC to work on, and the dedication to go through with it. So what grand new things have Carmack and Romero been up to since Masters of Doom's publication? As you might expect, plenty. For Romero, the original rock star of the game industry, the past decade has been lower profile but highly productive, often in ways that many of his most ardent fans and critics might not realize. When I last wrote about Romero, in the 2004 edition of Masters of Doom, he and id Software co-founder Tom Hall had moved to San Diego to work for Midway, creator of Mortal Kombat and other classic games. But before long, he was back on his own again. In 2005, Romero moved to Silicon Valley and co-founded a new development studio, Slipgate Ironworks, a nod to the teleporters in Quake. When announcing his plans, he hit back against the gamers who still took him to task for his post-id shooter, Daikatana. "Hey, Daikatana's old, old news now," he said at the time. "And the fact that everyone remembers that particular game instead of the dozens of other games I've made just shows how negatively slanted the media is. Negativity sells." He also hinted that gamers would likely be surprised to see what was coming from him next. What came were massively multiplayer online games, or MMOs, a genre that was gaining popularity with the recently released World of Warcraft and had long been of interest to him. Romero folded his company into another he co-founded, Gazillion Entertainment, which struck a high-profile deal to develop MMOs for Marvel and gobbled up NetDevil, the company behind another high-profile online brand, the LEGO Universe. Though the MMOs would have mixed success, Romero was soon pursuing new games and a new relationship. Brenda Brathwaite was a veteran game designer and one of the most influential women in what had long been a male-dominated industry. She and Romero had plenty in common, having seen the changes in this business over 4 decades. The two began dating, and in 2010, co-designed Ravenwood Fair, a social game for Facebook, and probably the furthest game one could imagine from Romero's most famous game, Doom. Ravenwood Fair cast the player as a warm, fuzzy forest animal who had to whittle down trees and create a fair to attract other cutesy creatures, all the while warding off scary monsters in the woods. Though there were none of the bloody jibs or marauding imps that had made Romero famous, Ravenwood Fair scored big, with more than 4 million players in its first month alone. Romero and Brathwaite took their winning partnership further and married in 2012. The ceremony was at Disneyland on the Mark Twain ship and officiated by Romero's old id buddy, Tom Hall. Brenda took Romero's last name, and together they made game-making a family business. They co-founded their own company, Loot Drop, and brought Hall in to help design. Before long, the next generation of Romeros was getting in on the action, too. One day, Romero's 10-year-old stepson, Donovan, suggested they make a game called Gunman Taco Truck. Romero arched his brow. "That's a cool name, man," he told the kid. They recorded Donovan making his pitch, which sounded like something Romero himself might have dreamed up at that age. "It's 2020, and you have to drive your taco truck across a post-apocalyptic landscape, blowing up mutant beasts and using their meat for tacos to help humanity survive." One of Romero's other sons, Michael, was also working with the group, and they decided to work together to bring Donovan's title to life. "Let's just start making it as a family game," Romero said. They funded it under their own development studio, Romero Games. The game was eventually picked up by Adult Swim for release in June 2015. John Romero is also revisiting at least one game from his own youth, Dangerous Dave. While at Soft Disk, the Shreveport-based company where he would later meet Carmack and Hall, Romero created the Dangerous Dave hero based on the local Southerners in town. Little did Romero know that long after he left Soft Disk, Dangerous Dave carried on a life of his own. Because the game ran fast on PCs at the time, it found a ready audience around the world, particularly for no apparent reason, in India. "The game is bigger in India than Doom," said Romero, who has been getting fan mail from the country for years. Sensing an opportunity, he bought the rights back to the game and is now working on a mobile version of Dangerous Dave. As for whether or not he might revisit some of the id games that made him famous, however, Romero isn't so optimistic. "I don't think it will happen," he told me. "Out of four of us that started id, three of us talk to each other all the time. He and Hall are still in touch, as he is with Adrian Carmack, no relation to John, who left id Software and is now in the hotel business. But one of the co-founders remains on his own." Romero told me, "We never talked to Carmack." One afternoon 15 years ago in Mesquite, Texas, I was interviewing John Carmack, when once again, the conversation turned to one of his greatest passions, virtual reality. Carmack had been fascinated by the idea since watching Star Trek The Next Generation as a teenager and imagining what it would be like to bring the show's holodeck to life. Since then, id's games, with their fast action and first-person point-of-view immersion, had transported players deeper and deeper into Carmack's own alternate worlds. But true virtual reality was still something he wanted to achieve. "It's a moral imperative that we create this," he told me at the time, referencing a line from the 1985 movie Real Genius. Little did he know, there was a teenage whiz kid in California who, after reading Masters of Doom, took Carmack's missive very much to heart. "Carmack said it's a moral imperative that we create this," Palmer Luckey, the founder of Oculus VR, told me several years later. "When Carmack has worked on a technology in the past," Luckey said, "when he has taken an interest in something, it always ends up being huge. To see him working on VR was reassuring. It was clear that this had a good shot at getting to a lot of different people." In the years following Masters of Doom's publication, however, Carmack had other missions in mind. He's since been immersed in many other projects. Doom 3, the making of which is chronicled later in the story collection and in my 2003 Wired article, Prepare to Meet Thy Doom, was released in 2004 to great acclaim. Id's follow-up, Rage, followed to mixed reviews in 2011. Carmack was also busy building rocket-powered vehicles, hoping to create suborbital and eventually orbital spacecraft. And he was well on his way. In 2008, Carmack's company Armadillo Aerospace won the $350,000 Level 1 XPRIZE Lunar Lander Challenge and the following year picked up another $500,000 prize. But Carmack's interest in virtual reality...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.